Exciting to have you all here for this discussion, Living Socialist Feminism and the Politics and Practice of Clara Fraser. So my name's Ella and I'll be chairing the event. I'd first like to begin with an acknowledgement of country. So we're meeting on the unceded lands of the Wurundjeri, Woiwurrung and Boonwurrung peoples. We stand in solidarity with the people of the Kulin Nations and all First Nations people. We commit to the fight shoulder to shoulder as they assert their sovereignty and demand justice. We embrace the quote by Murray activist Lila Watson, who rejected do-gooders and taught about the true meaning of solidarity when she said, "If you've come to help me, you're wasting your time. But if you've come because you understand that our liberation is bound up with mine, then let us work together." Capitalism has been built in this country on theft, stolen land, stolen languages, and stolen children. It is also built on the theft of labour of First Nations workers, as well as the exploitation of workers brought here to toil for capitalists. Always was, always will be Aboriginal land. So this event is being held by the Freedom Socialist Party, which is a socialist feminist revolutionary organisation. And it's committed to fighting against capitalist exploitation and oppression. The FSP champions leadership of the most vulnerable and oppressed, be they immigrants, people of colour, women, and members of the LGBTQ+ community. It's fiercely internationalist, supporting causes around the world, such as the struggles of the people in Palestine, Ukraine, Iran, the Kurds, Tamils, and Western Papuans. It builds solidarity with workers everywhere, including those in the 21st century industrial heartlands, in Asia, such as Bangladesh and China. So if you're interested in learning more about the FSP, our party pamphlet will be available on the lit table, so that'd be a great place to start. We're meeting today to celebrate the centennial of the birth of Clara Fraser, a trailblazing feminist revolutionary socialist who co-founded the FSP in 1966. Clara was born on March 12th, 1923 in Los Angeles to a Jewish immigrant parents and had a radical upbringing. She started her journey as a socialist organizer in the Socialist Workers' Party. Along with comrades from the Seattle branch, Clara split from the SWP to form the FSP due to the marginalization of the struggle of women and POC by a party bureaucracy that did not recognize the dynamism of these workers. Her leadership in the FSP set alight the fire of socialist feminism within the revolutionary movement. She authored numerous works, and I'm currently reading Revolution She Wrote, and I really connected with her wit, her analysis, and her optimism. Until her death in 1998, she was a staunch defender of workers, a keen organizer, and a dedicated educator. Her legacy lives on through the FSP's continued struggle and solidarity with the movements of today. So we'll now be hearing from our two speakers, Morty Osborne and Alison Thorne. So we'll first hear from Morty, and Morty is a millennial inspired by Clara Fraser's revolutionary legacy. Having been a retail worker since her mid-teens and a member of the Retail and Fast Food Workers Union, she's about to embark on a new role as a public service worker, where she will continue Freedom Socialist Party's decades of organizing in the community and public sector union. Morty led the work of both radical women and the FSP in the trade union movement.
Thank you.
Hello, and thank you, Ella, and thank you all for gathering here with us today to speak about the life and legacy of Clara Fraser, a trailblazing feminist organiser and political revolutionary. It is impossible to cover the breadth and timeline of Clara's extraordinary life in a short span of time, but I know that Alison and I will do our best to convey the remarkable life and legacy of this extraordinary comrade. As one of the FSP's younger comrades, I did not get the opportunity to work with Clara personally. However, we are fortunate enough to be with people here today who knew Clara well and collaborated with her extensively for decades. It goes without saying that Clara's remarkable legacy continues to live on across borders and oceans, but the question pertains, who was Clara Fraser? Clara Fraser was born to Jewish immigrant parents in an East Los Angeles ghetto on March 12, 1923. She was the daughter of a socialist Russian garment worker and an anarchist Latvian truck driver, who undoubtedly instilled in her radical politics. While in high school, Clara got her first taste of revolutionary organizing when she joined the Socialist Workers' Party's youth group in junior high school. After graduating and working her way through college, attending the University of California in Los Angeles, she joined the Socialist Workers' Party, the SWP, in 1946. In 1948, eventually relocated to Seattle. Clara moved to Seattle initially to assist the Socialist Workers' Party's branch, which became distinctive for its high level of activism in the midst of the McCarthyite 1950s and for its theoretical work on black liberation. To pay the rent, she worked as an assembly line electrician in Boeing and participated in the strike of 1948. The Boeing strike was an industrial dispute that lasted 20 weeks from April 22nd to September 13th, 1948. Clara would go on to describe the strike as a, quote, wonderful and tragic strike that lost, unquote. Forced to fight the labor-hating, union-busting, scab-herding, strike-breaking Boeing Airplane Co., as well as the labor-hating, union-busting, scab-herding, strike-bearing Teamsters head Dave Beck, who colluded with the company to raid and smash the Aero Mechanics Union, union bureaucracy, press hostility, scabs, intimidation, and exploitation. The majority of Boeing strikers bravely held out. The ones that couldn't stand the gaff were the union officials. But Clara flourished during the strike. Her socialist politics and leadership that had grounded her in the SWP came into force when, in response to an anti-picketing junction, she formed a mother's brigade which walked the line with strollers. She was immediately fired and blacklisted. The FBI pursued Clara for a decade. But in spite of this loss, Clara's revolutionary optimism never faltered. In fact, it was this optimism that continues to live on in our organizing today. It goes without saying that Clara is responsible for so much of our approach to union and workplace organizing in the FSP. During my time working in retail, I was heavily involved in a number of union campaigns during the COVID-19 pandemic. These campaigns around workplace health and safety, anti-sexism, and our company's response to the COVID-19 lockdowns were kickstarted by workers from the bottom. I worked proudly with my comrades in the union and in the FSP, the latter of which I attribute to understanding the necessity and need for grassroots organizing. As a result of this experience I have gained, I'm eager to take it forth with me, the experience and knowledge I've gotten into my new public sector job, which I coincidentally start tomorrow. Mm-hmm. My new union, the CPSU, is currently involved in a number of dynamo campaigns, which you can read about in our new issue of the FSO. It goes without saying that Clara's gung-ho role in the Boeing strike, combined with her socialist politics, were a harmonious union of both theory and action at work. It was also during this time that she met and married her second husband, Richard Fraser, leader of the Socialist Workers' Party. Along with a group of co-thinkers in Seattle and Los Angeles, she helped her husband develop the concept of revolutionary integration, which you will hear more about. Her marriage to Richard Fraser during this period, she described in his obituary, Dick was a bold and original thinker and organizer with a broad grasp of world history, economics, and politics. He was also a compelling orator, teacher, and writer, and an administrator with singular drive and energy, and a winning public persona. But like many male revolutionaries, he was ethically contradictory. For 10 years, I was his collaborator and wife, and he appeared to champion women's emancipation. but he never actually accepted and internalized women's equality, and this led him to indulge in vulgar machoism, and I left him. Clara was right. This was a problem amongst so many male revolutionaries. Their inability to take the so-called women's question seriously during the first wave feminist movement would come crumbling down for so many leftist organizations. Clara knew that the enemy of freedom for both women and men was one thing and one thing only, capitalism. She realized that the patriarchal capitalist class relies on women for the extraction of unpaid domestic labor and simultaneously exploits women in still another way, as a vast pool of cheap labor. The bosses reap their super profits from the hides of females. That is why the bourgeoisie can no more eradicate sexism than it can eliminate racism, which provides similar economic super benefits to capital. All wage exploitation would have to go in the bargain. But it was also during this period that Clara would go on to divorce Richard, and this was around the same time that the Seattle branch of the Socialist Workers' Party left the organization entirely. In 1966, Clara went on to found the Freedom Socialist Party, which you will hear more about from Alison. It goes without saying that Clara's vital legacy was founding the Freedom Socialist Party in 1966 and Radical Women in 1967, two tough revolutionary Marxist feminist organizations. Clara is aptly described as the big bang that set off modern socialist feminism, pouring new light and creative energy into the revolutionary movement. Radical Women was formed in response to what can only be described as a stain on the New Left movement. Radical Women is described as the revolutionary wing of the women's movement and a strong feminist voice within the left. Its multi-issue organizing is what made it so unique, not just within the left, but the feminist movement overall, with its role continuing today. But to the predominantly male left, the FSP was an abjuration, a Leninist party led by a woman, socialist feminism, no way. But Clara was familiar with these attitudes. Ever since feminists have organized the modern movement in the 60s, we have been harvarded from all sides for being insane, unfulfilled, petty bourgeois, narcissistic, frivolous, home wreckers, strident bitches, dykes, man haters, and enemies of civility and civilization. In her brilliant text, Socialist Feminism, Where the Battles of the Sexes Resolves Itself, Clara wrote that the women question has historically been indissolubly linked to the class struggle. But at the same time, the founders of the feminist movement always highlighted the dual nature of women's oppression. All women, regardless of class, are subjected to political, legal, cultural, and economic discrimination, and this subjugation of an entire sex confers an independent character to women's struggle. This, I think, really highlights the multi-issue nature of Clara's politics and why she emphasized the role of class. Clara always said that class is the power that heals, and this quote alone certainly captures the FSP's understanding of the dual nature of both class and feminism. We know that capitalism cannot eradicate sexism or racism or poverty or war or wage exploitation without killing itself. We know that the solution to this is socialism through a fiercely independent political party of the working class and other minority groups. We know that feminism, women's rights, is inseparable from socialism, but feminism isn't identical to socialism. Rather, feminism, like all struggles for liberation, is a reason for socialism, a catalyst to organize for socialism and a benefit for socialism. I remember having what I would later call a light bulb moment when I came into contact with the FSP's sister organization, Radical Women. As a young teenager, I related to the struggles for secure work, and the sexist discrimination women and girls faced all over the world angered me. When meeting and conversing with Debbie, Melbourne's Radical Women organizer, I remember her distinctly telling me that the root cause of oppression wasn't just patriarchy. It was an economic system we live under called capitalism. In-depth conversations about class and how capitalism exploits the labor of workers for profit followed. I knew I had to be involved in an organization at a serious level if patriarchal capitalism was to be toppled and for workers to gain control of society. But I also knew that the organization had to be socialist feminist. Clara's writings on socialist feminism, I believe, is one of the many reasons I was attracted to the party in the first place.
I knew innately that bourgeois and radical feminism didn't cut the mustard, so to speak, in terms of their political approach to multi-issue organizing. Socialist feminists, they were right, sharply differentiate themselves from the political opportunism and the delusions of reformist sector of the movement and are recognized exponents of the radical alternative. Here was a political home that was serious about the liberation of each and every human being on the face of this planet, with a unique perspective and tangible way of organizing and uniting people. This is another thing I observed about the FSP and also a testament to Clara's legacy. The party's diversity, its multi-generational membership and multi-issue politics, as well as how the energy of younger comrades filters into the mentoring and teachings of more experienced comrades. Last year, I attended the FSP's annual convention in Seattle, and I saw this in action. I was so struck, enthralled, and motivated after attending and interacting with comrades from all over the US and the world. Seeing comrades' revolutionary spirit and optimism bounce off one another was exhilarating and exciting. Watching comrades young and old display incredible leadership again reflects teachings of Clara. Ultimately, the way in which Clara viewed leadership, her understanding of the importance in mentoring and training a younger generation of comrades, is attributed to how the party continues to function today. I myself am fortunate enough to be mentored by comrades in the party who have taught and continue to teach me so much about what it takes to be a leader in the FSP. This is possible because Clara was a living example of what leadership is, not telling people what to do, but rather leadership as being an example of what everyone can mold into. Need it be said that Clara was no armchair radical. She worked for black women to win abortion rights in Washington State in 1960, 3 years before Roe v. Wade. She developed a powerful training program to bring women into the trades at Seattle City Light and won protections for leftists in the Freeway Hall case and the extension of local anti-discrimination laws to political and sexual minorities. She was always asking, what's best for the working class? Clara was also a staunchly anti-Zionist Jew. She stood with Palestinians and criticized the US backing of Israel. As early as the 1950s, Fraser saw the necessity of organizing collaboratively across ethnic, racial, gender, and sexual divisions. In fact, decades ago, Clara wrote that Israel's horrifying treatment of the Palestinian people is no aberration for the direct and inexorable product of expropriating Arab land for the exclusive Jewish state. Those Jewish progressives who do not agree should still recognize this point of view as an honest political position and not the product of anti-Semitism or Jewish self-hatred. Those Jewish progressives who do not agree should still recognize this point. The FSP's decades-long involvement in the Palestinian liberation movement is attributed to Clara's political understanding that neither the struggle for Palestinian rights nor the fight against anti-Semitism can be won without a united effort by people who share a hatred of oppression. Clara would be proud to know that the party as it stands today, is continuing to champion and fight for the rights of Palestinians and say no to anti-Semitism and no to Zionism. Yes to cooperation for justice and peace in the Middle East. Clara's logical, clever, and humorously writings just put forward in the Freedom Socialist, of which she was a founder of. The Freedom Socialist and Freedom Socialist Organizer live on thanks to Clara, who saw the need for independent radical left-wing press. As a matter of fact, we currently have a subscription drive running at the moment, which I all would implore you to check out today after the talk, which can be found over at the literature table. Clara's thoughts, writings, and theories have been collected in her excellent book, Revolution, she wrote. Consummate teacher, connoisseur of fine food, which you will get to experience later today during the meal, and art, a sharp sense of humor and wit. Clara had the true heart and mind of a beautiful American revolutionary.
Thank you so much, Maureen, for that wonderful speech. We'll now be hearing from Alison. So Alison Thorne, who founded the FSP in Melbourne, had the privilege of working with Clara Fraser. Alison is a managing editor of Freedom Socialist Organizer, a member of the community and public sector union active in the militant democracy for CPSU caucus, and she leads the work of both radical women and FSP in the LGBTQI+ and Aboriginal movements. Take it away.
Great, thanks, Ella. And thanks very much to Maudy for her reflections, speaking as a comrade who's been incredibly motivated by Clara Fraser's legacy. Maudy has not only learnt from Clara's writing, but also from some of us, like myself, who work directly with this incredible and talented leader. A talented leader who trained upcoming generations to be Marxist feminist leaders. I'm lucky, I'm one of those comrades who was privileged to know Clara Fraser. And although she was living in Seattle while I was in Melbourne, I really cannot overstate how much I learnt from Clara. At the core of the Marxist movement is theoretical continuity. This is something that's traced right back to Marx and to Engels. And each generation learns the method of scientific socialism and how to apply it to the issues of the day from those who came before them. Clara Fraser learned directly from James P. Cannon, the founder of US Trotskyism, a leader who had worked directly with Russian revolutionary leader Leon Trotsky. That's an example of the revolutionary continuity. And the vehicle for ensuring continuity is the Revolutionary Party. Through a vanguard party, the working class trains its leaders. And I very much view the party as an intensive school in class struggle. It provides theoretical development, honing the ability to think critically. The party is also something that builds practical skills, from intervening in a union, organising an event like this one today, writing an article, leading a contingent at a rally, building a disciplined response to the fascist threat, speaking on radio or running a social media campaign. All of these skills are things that are learned, and the party provides encouragement to members to push themselves, and it provides education by example. And this is exactly what Clara Fraser did. She was a brilliant leadership builder with a great, great interest in people. And when Clara met someone new, she always wanted to know what it was that they were interested in. And she then used this to work out what it was that made them tick and how best she could connect with them. Clara was a wonderful mentor, and she was not somebody that dispensed answers. She used questions as an incredibly powerful tool. Clara would listen to what you had to say, then without telling you directly what she thought, she would ask a series of incisive questions. And what her aim was to get others to think critically for themselves and eventually to be able to do this effortlessly. Everything and every person that she came into contact with, she improved. Clara not only knew how to critique and fix things, but she taught other people these skills as well. Those who worked with her not only came up with a good product, but expanded their abilities and became more proficient. I first met Clara Fraser in 1982. In my hunt for a socialist feminist organisation that didn't treat feminism and gay liberation as marginal at best, I'd come across some Freedom Socialist Party documents and was absolutely blown away by the ideas that I encountered. and I travelled to Seattle eager to find out more. And I remember quite distinctly some of my conversations with Clara, as she used a very short time to prepare me to head back to the other side of the world to start a branch. One of the things Clara did was encourage confidence. In particular, I learned not to fear making mistakes. Mistakes are for learning from. The point Clara made is not to make the same mistakes twice. Make a new one. Clara was a brilliant mass movement organizer, and a key thing that she taught me was always have clear objectives and participate in mass movement activity with a policy. I'd been a member for less than a year when I went to a gay community public meeting to discuss what we now know as HIV/AIDS. And my policy as an FSP member was to raise the alarm about the emerging health crisis and to show that this health crisis was also a serious, serious political threat, and to rally the community to action. That intervention, taking an approach learnt from Clara, sparked the formation of the Victorian AIDS Action Committee, the start of an effective gay community response. And today, in recognition of that leadership, we're meeting in the home of an organisation now called Thorn Harbour Health. So thank you to Thorn Harbour Health for this lovely venue for this gathering. The importance of always knowing in advance what you want to accomplish and carrying it out and then evaluating if it was the right policy is something that Clara drummed into every member, me included. I learned so much more from Clara, things that we recognise in the FSP today. Clara and I discussed the rich ideas at the heart of the FSP's program. She stressed the importance of always, always orienting to the most oppressed. Pay special attention to those mistreated by the rest of the left was something that Clara urged. And I recollect how impressed I was that the FSP had been amongst the very first to embrace gay liberation, diving headlong into the movement from the get-go. But one of the messages that I really internalised from those early conversations with Clara was that as a young queer woman worker and trade unionist, who is white, that I had to really learn about the struggles of First Nations and people of colour, including how to listen and how to collaborate in the fight. Clara had forged many successful collaborations with women of colour. She worked with Native American leader Janet McLeod on early fishing rights struggles and mobilised support for the Puyallup Nation when tribal chair Ramona Bennett led an armed occupation of Cascadia Juvenile Diagnostic Centre to reclaim the land and building for her people. Clara partnered with black women, as Maudie's mentioned, to win legalised abortion in Washington state. And what was important was how early and how pioneering that was. It was 3 years before the landmark Roe versus Wade decision, which has now been tragically overturned. Clara also stood shoulder to shoulder with the black community fighting to control the police, and she worked with the Black Panthers defending the group from government repression. Clara's advice to me was go and get educated about the struggles of people of colour and First Nations and put these issues front and centre in building a branch in Melbourne. She also taught me how important it was to have theoretical clarity. This meant understanding the difference between racism and national oppression. The tool of racism is segregation. In contrast, the basis of national oppression is assimilation, and the fight is for self-determination and to maintain one's identity as a people. Clara learnt her theory in the Socialist Workers' Party. She'd moved to Seattle in 1948, where the SWP branch there became distinctive for both its high level of activism in the midst of the McCarthyite 1950s and for its theoretical work on black liberation. Along with a group of co-thinkers in Seattle and Los Angeles, Clara helped Richard Fraser, her second husband, develop the concept of revolutionary integration, as Morty's mentioned. This landmark theory demonstrates that the main direction of the black struggle in the US, unlike First Nations struggle here, has been towards integration and equality, not separation. That this aspiration can only be achieved through socialism, and the black leadership and an onslaught against racism are crucial to unifying a working class divided and corrupted by white privilege. Unfortunately, the increasingly bureaucratic Socialist Workers' Party leadership rejected this revolutionary approach to black liberation. In 1965, the Socialist Workers' Party banned discussion of dissident views at its conventions, a death blow to democracy within the party. And in January 1966, the entire branch of the Socialist, the Seattle branch of the Socialist Workers' Party resigned. Within 5 months, they'd reorganized as the Freedom Socialist Party with a Trotskyist program of internationalism, revolutionary integration, and as you've heard from Morty, socialist feminism. The new party analysed what had gone wrong in the once great Socialist Workers' Party, which it characterised as being radical labourite. What radical labourism is an orientation to the more privileged workers and the union bureaucracy, while failing to appreciate the dynamism being shown by the most oppressed sectors of the working class. The SWP failed to recognise the upcoming upsurge amongst women in the form of the women's liberation movement, people of colour, including the civil rights movement, and queers with the gay liberation movement that exploded after the Stonewall riots. Instead, it oriented to straight white male unionised blue collar workers. And unfortunately, McCarthyism had a corrosive and isolating impact on the increasingly conservative US unions. And to quote Clara from her classic piece, The Dialectics of US Backwardness, Clara said, "White skin privilege, male chauvinism and heterosexism have turned millions of workers into lackeys of the boss, shorn of class consciousness and permeated with elitism. This is the social base of the labour bureaucracy. But these aristocrats of labour, the labour lieutenants of the capitalist class, are the ebb tide sector in the labour movement, being swiftly replaced and ignored by the army of new worker militants from the ranks of women, youth, minorities, and lesbians and gays." 2 years after the formation, the FSP split over its first test of feminism in practice, when Clara sought a divorce from Richard Fraser, who, as Morty's mentioned, was another FSP founder. Shamefully, while he could talk socialist feminism, Dick Fraser charged Clara in the capitalist courts, no less, with being, wait for this, an unfit wife and mother because of her political activism. Appalling. The young FSP, grounded in its socialist feminism, supported Clara, who carried the day in court as well. And for a short time in its early history, the FSP was an all-women party led by Clara and her close colleagues, Melba Windoffer and Gloria Martin. But that soon changed as a younger generation of men, inspired by the party's principled revolutionary feminism, began to join. Hurrah! Clara knew that revolution against capitalism requires a vanguard party to guide and unite workers in all our diversity. Despite the scoffers, she took on the mammoth project of creating such a party. And this feat was made even more difficult because much of the left dismissed the FSP because of its socialist feminism and women's leadership. But Clara was tough and Clara was tenacious, and she excelled in the continuous, consistent and conscious building that James P. Cannon described as necessary for forming a party to defeat a capitalist system driven by profit. Clara built leadership teams of members who had each other's back. She stressed the importance of theoretical grounding. She taught how to operate based on unshakable principles, and she led the party to embrace involvement in issues of the day. She stressed internationalism while emphasizing that revolution in the imperialist heartland is key to progress everywhere else. Clara advocated James P. Cannon's tradition of collaborative leadership, writing and publishing, class struggle unionism, left recruitment, and never ever giving up without a fight. And with this approach, from being a small band of female revolutionaries based in Seattle, the party grew to become a multi-generational, multiracial and gender diverse party that it is today. Now, the FSP was just 16 years old, but it was well and truly a going concern by the time I met Clara and the party she built. The Freedom Socialist newspaper was being published on a regular basis, and branches had been established in other parts of the US. Radical Women, an autonomous women's leadership organization that Clara and other party women had co-founded in 1967, was absolutely flourishing. Clara had just won an epic battle for the right to be radical on the job. In 1973, she'd landed a job at the local power company called Seattle City Light, and her job was as training and education coordinator. And in this role, she was charged with implementing a program to hire and train women electrical workers. She did this with great gusto, even when management began to undermine its own program. The utility fired Clara in 1974 in retaliation for her tenacious defense of affirmative action and her leadership of a massive 11-day wildcat strike. The head of City Light, Clara's boss, hated her political commitment, and he famously said, "If Clara was as loyal to me as she is to Karl Marx, I'd hire her back in a minute." 8 years later, though, Clara won her fight. And at the same time, she won the right of all city workers to criticise managers and to speak openly on the job about their opinions. Her return to work in 1982, earlier you know, in the year just before I met Clara, was something that was absolutely triumphant. And she ended up remaining a vocal opponent of discrimination at the utility. When Clara retired on her own terms 4 years later, this made news headlines in the main paper, the Seattle Times, which described Clara as City Light's in-house conscience. Clara and comrades really knew how to fight and win. And at the heart of the strategy was to form a defence committee and to build mass union and community support. And just a year after I joined the party, I needed the fighting advice that Clara could provide when I was removed from classroom teaching for my gay liberation activism. Everyone around me advised me, Alison, you've got to do what the union officials tell you. You've got to follow the lawyer's instructions. You've got to go quiet. And whatever you do, don't talk to the press. Clara did not agree. BS, she said to that advice. And with her guidance, I formed the committee to reinstate Alison Thorne to keep the pressure on the union leadership. We went to the press to publicise the case and rally support. And I told the lawyers that they give advice, but I give instructions. And I firmly believe that I would not have won my precedent-setting case at the Victorian Equal Opportunity Board in 1986, which extended protections for all queer radicals. I would not have won that case without the lessons from Clara's fight at City Light and the inspirations this provided. And to learn these lessons, I highly, highly, highly recommend the book High Voltage Women, which is available in the lit store. So Clara's influence was something that reverberated around the world. She knew that poor and working people have more in common across the globe with our class siblings than we do with our bosses and the capitalist class at home. And she was a keen internationalist who helped coordinate several delegations of members who visited the Middle East, Northern Ireland, the former Soviet Union, Eastern Europe, China, and Cuba. And in 1997, she provided invaluable guidance in planning and launching the first ever International Feminist Brigade to Cuba, which was undertaken by radical women and the Federation of Cuban Women. And Debbie was part of that International Feminist Brigade. So over dinner, if you want to know more, chat to Debbie about it. And when the Soviet Union began its slide towards collapse, Clara turned her attention to the events unfolding, warning that only workers' revolt could stave this off. The Russian Revolution and the founding of the USSR marked a turning point for the world working class, and so did its breakdown. Clara recognised the opportunities present in that crisis, as she did in every crisis. She argued that these earth-shattering events were our chance to show why Stalinism was never socialism. She urged comrades to vigorously expound on Trotskyism, the real socialism, and to expose Stalinism for its terrible betrayals. Clara motivated both the party and radical women to send members to Russia and Eastern Europe, and the Freedom Socialist published a special edition on the Great Soviet Shake-up, which explained the events. In 1995, Clara dedicated her Freedom Socialist column to a piece titled Hail the Once and Future Soviet Union. And she urged her readers, instead of succumbing to confusion and melancholia and despair over the fall of the world's first workers' state, we must commemorate it and illuminate its lessons so that we can proceed to stage Act Two with a greater wisdom born from experience. Clara understood the importance of history and was always an immense optimist. But far from being utopian, this belief in a better future for humanity flowed from her ideas. Understanding the source of oppression is absolutely pivotal to working out what is to be done. And in a 1989 keynote address at the Parallels and Intersections Conference, Clara explained it this way. All of the many brands of oppression, racism, sexism, heterosexism, ageism, classism, are historical. They have not been always with us. It was not ever thus, and it is not going to be this way come the revolution. Whenever I say that, somebody always objects. Oh, yeah? You can't change human nature. Wrong. My business as a socialist is changing human nature away from the distortion that capitalism has made of it. Oppressions grew, they developed, not out of somebody's evil mind, but out of material reality. End quote. This knowledge that a world divided by inequality was not inevitable is very profound, like Maudie's light bulb moment. Clara was always excited by the ideas, and she dedicated her life to sharing them with others and making them accessible for everyone. She always knew the enormous resources that working people can call on when they're roused to fight, because she'd studied and lived through world-changing events. And she had every confidence in the Marxist idea that socialist revolution is both necessary and inevitable. This year, the centennial of Clara Fraser's birth has been a brilliant opportunity to both reflect on her 74-year life as well as the legacy she left that continues to endure. Clara poured a lifetime of energy into training generations of activists to become organisers, theoreticians, writers, journalists, publishers, fundraisers, bookkeepers, public speakers, cooks, graphic artists, critical thinkers, mass movement movers and shakers, and on-the-job union organisers. Clara understood that everyone has a contribution to make, and she put huge emphasis into creating effective and collaborative teams of leaders. Due to Clara's tenacity, skills, tough love, and example, the Freedom Socialist Party has survived, flourished, and stayed true to its roots now for 57 years. And in her 1994 column for the Freedom Socialist, Class, The Power That Heals, which I think Maudie also quoted from, Clara explains that oppressions are all tied together with class, and that this is what binds us together. She also explains the importance of the Revolutionary Party. Quote, when a revolt takes place without a party, the movement will not endure. Huge errors of strategy and tactics will be made. Key lessons will not be drawn. Only the Revolutionary Party can ensure that activists and agitators become political professionals, geared and educated for the long haul. Only the party can help the militant strike or sit-in or electoral upheaval take the next leaps forward and aim for state power. Only the party can extend isolated insurgencies into constant, concerted mobilizations for the total revamping of society, end quote. Now, Clara was very fond of saying, nothing is too good for the working class. And her life project was fighting for the future that we truly deserve. Clara knew that a better world is possible because she really believed in the capacity of all of us, the capacity of her class, to take power and to run the world for human need, not corporate greed. And I have a poster on my fridge at home, and it's now here. It came with us today, and it's actually, this is based on the artwork that was designed for a Melbourne Radical Women cookbook that was created to fundraise for the Freedom Socialist newspaper and organiser. And it actually quotes Clara's brilliant column in the Freedom Socialist called Comes the Revolution, a Simple To-Do List. And I'll end by sharing this with you. Reviewing Clara's 7-point plan inspires me every time I open the fridge. Like I look at it and I'm inspired. And this is what Clara says. Just clip the following post-seizure of power menu, memorize it and slap it on your fridge door. And she says, one, restructure the government into divisions and jobs that make sense, that reflect our needs and express our hopes and ideals. Two, squelch any counter-revolutionary machinations. Peacefully remove as many kvetches as possible. Three, expropriate the expropriators in one fell swoop. Transfer all private property from giant capitalists to public ownership. Nationalize the banks, great factories, natural resources, agribusiness, communication and transportation networks, utilities, media conglomerates, and the like. Four, plan and reorganize these operations to create full employment, maximum output of needed goods, and an efficient, environment-friendly, and waste-free production process. Five, back to basics, complete funding for enriched education, training, health, housing, recreation, and the general welfare. Six, let a million cultural flowers bloom, spark an explosion of rich, creative, diversified, and exciting art in all its form. And seven, this is my favourite, I can't wait to get to this. Have a nice life for a change. So, like, imagine that. And there will never be another exactly like Clara Fraser, but there will be many, many others in her tradition. And I salute Clara. Thank you, Clara, for helping prepare me to carry the beautiful, liberating struggle for international socialism into the future. And if you'd like to be part of this, let's talk.
Thank you very much, Alison, for that wonderful speech. And thank you again, Wardy. I know for sure that I feel very inspired by my comrades in the FSP and learning from the tradition of Clara Fraser as well. So we'll now be moving into our discussion. And so the way...